Hello everybody, Teagan here with High Point, and we want to thank you so much for tuning in to another episode of What is in the Night Sky. This is our first episode in the year of 2023, so we are going to kick it off with a tour of the night sky in the month of January. Tonight I will be taking you through a tour of the galaxy and the universe. I will be showing you different deep sky objects, star clusters, and we're going to check out the moon and the planets. As always, buckle in and let's see what's really out there. The first two objects that we're going to visit tonight are deep sky objects, and more specifically, they're called open clusters, Messier 35 and Messier 41. There are a handful of open clusters in the constellation of Gemini, but none are as large, nor as bright, nor as easy to find as Messier 35. Located near the curved line of three stars that mark Castor's feet, it's possible to glimpse the cluster with the naked eye from a dark location. The cluster can easily be found with binoculars from suburban locations, and it shows up well in telescopes of almost any size. Even 8x32 binoculars can show an hourglass shape with a potential for resolving the stars using averted vision. Telescopically, a low magnification of around 40 times is all you'll need to get the best views, with hundreds of stars being visible. Messier 35 lies roughly 3,000 light years away, but a neighboring cluster, NGC 2158, is a staggering 14,000 light years further, on the edge of the Milky Way galaxy itself. This makes it one of the most distant star clusters seen in our night sky. NGC 2158, that is, not Messier 35. The next open cluster is Messier 41. Like Messier 35, Messier 41 is a bright open cluster that's easily found just 4 degrees south of Sirius and Canis Major. Also, like M35, it's visible to the naked eye under dark skies and is a fine sight through binoculars or a telescope. Telescopically, it appears a little sparser than Messier 35, but with curving chains of stars that run from north to south. You might also notice a few orange stars scattered here and there, with one particular appearing just a little off-center. Now, the next deep sky object is not a star cluster, but rather a stellar nursery where stars are born. It is the most popular nebula in the Northern Hemisphere. That's Messier 42, the Orion Nebula. Although visible with the naked eye and binoculars, Orion's showcase nebula is really a must-see sight for telescopic observers. It is easily found just below the three stars of Orion's belt and is bright enough to be visible to the naked eye from suburban skies. Binoculars will show a small circular misty patch with a bright off-center core. A small telescope at low power will start to show some texture, and if you look carefully, you could also be able to see hints of green. Otherwise, the nebula looks like a little cloud illuminated by pale moonlight. Be sure to look out for the famous trapezium star cluster at its center. This tiny cluster is made up of young stars just 300,000 years old that formed within the nebula itself. Now, if you do get a chance to view this nebula under dark skies and with a large telescope, I have been able to observe the entirety of Orion's nebula through a 14-inch telescope under Bortle 3 skies, and it resembles the photos that you see. Now, the colors aren't as vibrant, but there are hints of green and pink through the eyepiece. It's an absolutely spectacular view, and definitely something that changes your perspective of what can be viewed through an eyepiece. The next Messier object on our list formed 1,000 years ago, Messier 1, the Crab Nebula. The Crab Nebula, the remnants of a star that exploded nearly 1,000 years ago, is conveniently located near the bright star Alnath in Taurus. It's visible as a faint dark gray patch through a small telescope, while large telescopes will show its irregular shape. Larger telescopes will also show some texture with averted vision, but the central star will elude you. It is a pulsar, one of the first of its kind to ever be discovered, and it is so called because it emits pulses of radiation once every 33 milliseconds. Now, hopefully you have seen this video before January 3rd, because on January 3rd is the Quadrantid meteor shower. This year's shower reaches its maximum at 10:40 p.m. Eastern time, but with the moon waxing gibbous, the best views might not come just a few hours before dawn, when the moon is lower over the western horizon. The shower's radiant, or the area of the night sky where the meteors will appear to originate, rises in the northeast at about 1 a.m. Since the moon will be setting in the west, keep your eyes turned toward the east for the best chance of spotting some shooting stars. Now, it is often asked, what is the best equipment to use to view a meteor shower successfully? Some ask whether it's a telescope or a pair of binoculars, but honestly, you need dark skies and your eyes. Just looking in the direction of the meteor shower or observing the night sky with your naked eye is going to present you the best experience while viewing a meteor shower. All right, so those are our deep sky objects that we're going to view tonight, and we're going to bring it a little bit closer to home, and we're going to see what the moon and the planets are up to. All of the planets are visible in the evening sky at the start of January. Mercury will appear within the same binocular field of view as Venus on January 1st, with Mercury appearing to the lower right of Venus at about 30 minutes after sunset. Venus then joins Saturn in Capricornus on the 2nd. The two planets will be within the same binocular field of view for the second half of the month and will be closest together on the 22nd, with just 20 arc seconds between them. Look for the crescent moon to the upper left of the pair the following night. The waxing moon hangs below brilliant Jupiter on the 25th, with the red giant still well-placed for observation in Pisces. Uranus is also in prime position among the stars of neighboring Aries, while Mars presumes prograde motion in Taurus on the 12th. If you live in the southern half of the United States, you could also enjoy the occultation of Mars by the moon on the 30th. Lastly, the moon turns full on the 6th, and then new again on the 21st. So that is it for our tour of the night sky in January 2023. We thank you so much for sticking with us through all of these episodes of What is in the Night Sky. If you have any questions or if you have viewed any of these objects, please let us know your experience in the comments below. We would love to hear your story. Please like and subscribe so you don't miss any future content. Clear skies.